So once again, good morning and assalamu alaikum to everyone. So today we will talk about a very important topic that every final year project student faces, or every new final year project student faces, which is what to include in your, what are you supposed to write or include in your thesis that you're supposed to submit at the end of semester two. So last week I asked you to prepare the briefs, which is a starting point. But definitely, you can think of the briefs really as registration. Really, you're just registering your topic. So, Amiro here. Amiro was, oh yeah, they're both Amiros are here. So, basically, the brief essentially is sort of the starting point of your thesis. Now, what happens in the brief, or even in PR1 or PR2, can always change later on. So let's talk about, you know what, let's not talk about the brief. The brief comes later. Let's just, I mean, we will talk about it later. Let's talk about the last part of your thesis, which is the last part, the last thing you will submit in your thesis, which is the thesis report itself. So I actually wrote it down in a discussion here, in our discussion in the Telegram group. I think I'm going to make slides at some point, but that will be maybe later, or maybe it's not that needed for now. So let's talk about what you're supposed to include in your final, in your thesis. And I think this is good enough. Now, obviously, the first chapter will have to be the introduction. And this is the very first thing you should be writing about. And in fact, after the end of this session, you should start writing your introduction chapter, because it's going to be required submission for PR1. By the way, when is the due for PR1?
Monday, sir.
Monday, so you have 1 week. Less than 1 week. So in this 1 week, or this is the next couple of, let's say, 6 or 5 days, you will have to submit and complete the chapter one. So what is actually included in chapter one? The very first part of chapter one is essentially is the background. Before you start talking about your own topic, you need to an introductory welcoming part of your thesis. If you are talking about, for example, an IoT device, for example, then you have to introduce what is IoT and what is, the Internet of Things and so on and so forth. I'm going to use your own titles as examples. So this is Amiral, and his title was about interactive garbage bin using Arduino. Good. We'll have to work on the title a little bit. I will tweak it a little bit, and then I'll let you know what is the final title. But let's just start with this. You see, this title right here involves a couple of things, like garbage disposal, is that right? This analysis, although it applies to Amiral and his title, you can definitely apply it on your old title as well. So garbage disposal, then you have Arduino, and I'm assuming you also have some elements of IoT, because although it's not mentioned in the title, but I know your topic. That involves notification over the internet, so somewhat there is some form of IoT or maybe internet-based notification. All right. So just go ahead.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
That's correct.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. Your microphone is too loud. It sort of blew up my ear. So maybe you can. Put the microphone a little bit away from your mouth, yeah. Okay. Okay, so then before you start talking about your topic itself, you should introduce these items. And when you talk about garbage disposal, just summarize. I know we all have an understanding of what garbage disposal is, but then that's not the point. When you write a thesis, you want to work, it's like you're welcoming someone to your room. You have a visitor, and the visitor is coming to visit your room, your own room in the house. You don't bring the person from the outside straight away into your room. They have to walk through the front yard, then the main living room, and then they will find their way into your room. And they have to think this way when you're writing your thesis. So you don't throw away jump title, throw away my title is about this and this and this. It's not about that. You do a little bit of introductory. That's what this section is all about. So we are talking about chapter one. So this will be section 1.1, which is introduction. Background. So in the background, you talk about the topics that are going to be used or introduced later on. So first thing is garbage disposal, maybe section 1.1, something like that. Then again, introduce Arduino. And yes?
Yeah, no, sir.
Okay, I'm going to mute all of them. Okay, so essentially 1.1 and 1.3. And these are suggestions, by the way, Amiro. It's not that you have to follow this. If you are, but the point is, whatever you're going to use later on must be in the background. Okay, what do you mean? I'll come to that in a minute. So basically, this is your sort of welcoming section of your thesis. Of course, you cannot invent a new science here. You have to get references and from the internet or Wikipedia, whatever, but then you have to have your own references and citations. The next section will be problem formulation. And this is where you begin to talk about the actual problem of your system. In here now, we begin to talk, okay, you introduced you introduce your topics. Okay, and all right, so what's next? So now we're ready, there's no such sections. Actually, there is. So there's, first of all, 1.2.1. That will be, let's just call it the formulation. Formulation, and then here will be 1.2.2, problem statement. So what's going on here, in the formulation, you describe the background as a problem. And in Amiro's case, I think one of the problem that he's facing is that essentially, or the problem not he is facing, that the project that this topic is facing, let's read exactly what he said, solid waste management is one of the problems, either impact of health, good traditional ways of manually monitoring the waste utilizes more human effort, time, and cost. Okay, so this is the key word right here, that we waste a lot of time and effort and costs to dispose of garbage. And this is a very short paragraph, but of course, in the background here, you'll have to explain more what you mean. You can provide examples. How is it that we are wasting money and time and effort disposing garbage? You can say that the workers, for example, they would have to walk from the garbage truck to every bin, open it, and look inside every bin to see whether there is garbage or it's already been removed or something like that. And many times the garbage man comes to the area and finds empty bins. So that journey that he made is a waste of time. Therefore, that's wasted man hours. You can then estimate how much of those are wasted and come up with a percentage. Say you can estimate according to statistics, 2 or 3 out of each walk to the house trip is finds an empty bin. So that was wasted. So 20% of the time the workers are doing nothing. So that's a waste of manpower. So here I am, I already developed some statistics and percentages. So this is where the formulation part is here. You formulate the problem. You could try to explain it in your own way. If you want to use a diagram or a chart or anything else, it's fine. As long as you try to explain the problem as much as possible. Explain it as much as possible. Okay? Of course, you may have to use references to justify your point. Not me. You have to use references. You came up with some statistics, for example. I said 20%. Where does that number come from? You must have found it from somewhere. So you must use references to justify the problem or to show there is a real problem and not invented by you. Okay. Or to show that it's a serious problem, that it's actually, maybe you can find a report or a paper published on this. Maybe there's something on it in the news. Maybe whatever source that is reliable, that we can refer to it, then you can add it here. That will be the problem. And now, the way you write this part of the formulation is in paragraph form, diagrams, charts. Basically, think of it like you are talking to a friend and trying to explain the problem. Now, if you find yourself do not introduce something new here, what does that mean? Do not introduce something new here. See, if you, while you're describing this technology and suddenly, let's say, for example, that, suddenly here you find yourself talking about interactive garbage bins. Or, you know what, let's say, for example, that we did not mention Arduino here. I'll just take it out of the way. And it was not mentioned. In your chapter here, we didn't have Arduino at all. You just talked about garbage disposal and IoT. And then suddenly, over here, you mentioned IoT, over here. You see, if you introduce IoT suddenly, this is considered something new. Something new means what? Something that was not mentioned here in the background. And the problem with this is that if you didn't introduce it earlier, then you have to introduce it here in the problem formulation. And that is a problem. The problem formulation must not, or the section of the problem formulation must be used specifically to talk about the problem, not to introduce a new topic. If you find yourself talking about a new topic here, then you copy paste it and you put it in the background. You get me? So you have to, if you, sometimes you're not sure what to put in the background because you don't know what everything is going to be in the thesis. You find yourself suddenly introducing something new here, let's say recycling. We did not talk about recycling at all before this point, but suddenly you are mentioning it here. So then you may have to, or maybe a recycling technique, for example. We know generally what recycling is, but you want to speak about a specific type of recycling. Well, this specific type of recycling was not introduced earlier into your thesis. So that is why it's not a good idea to introduce it here. If you find yourself suddenly talking about something new, well, just copy paste it, right? And then introduce it here. Another section, 1.1.4. So this way, by the time the reader comes to the problem formulation, they already know what this recycling technique is. So you don't have to introduce it. You just continue to talk about it. Does this point make sense? Is this point clear? Okay, so the point, go ahead.
So meaning, if I need to add anything new for formulation, I have to make sure it's inside the background, is it, sir?
Yes, that is correct.
All right.
Amiro, just now you have a question. The other Amiro, for those.
Sorry?
Did you have a question?
No, sir.
Okay. So you see, if you are wondering, sir, I already wrote this section. Can I come back later and change it? Of course, definitely. If you remember from my earlier notices in the Telegram group, I keep saying update this chapter. You want to keep updating this chapter all the way until the end, until the final thesis. And because you see, when you write chapter 3, which is methodology, once again, you find yourself introducing something new, you go back to the background and introduce it. If you're, let's say, writing the discussion analysis, and suddenly you want to mention a new topic that was not mentioned at all in the thesis, you introduce it in the background. You want to use the background simply as an introductory area, that you, whatever topic that is relevant to your thesis, it comes here. Maybe today, when you're writing it for the first PR1, you don't have much idea of what you're going to include here. So just do your best, and then later on, when you come for PR2, PR3, you update as you go along. Okay. All right, let's move on now to this. Now, after you have formulated the problem, formulation means you try to explain it in a collection of techniques, like you're using a paragraph, bullet points, diagrams, references. All of those collectively are designed to help you formulate the problem. And formulate the problem means you're trying to explain it clearly to the reader. You might understand what the problem is, It might be clear to you, but you have to understand one thing about the thesis writing, or in general, report writing. When you're writing a report, you should put your head, or you should put the reader, in, you should put yourself in the shoes of the reader. What does that mean? See, you yourself have a clear understanding of what you, the problem you're doing, or the problem you're trying to resolve, or solve in your project. But the reader has no idea what you are talking about. They didn't think like you, they didn't spend all this time studying or preparing. They are just looking at your report for the very first time. So when you write this part, imagine that you are talking to someone who has never heard about your topic before, and then explain it to them in that way. The best way to see if this part was written clearly is that after you write this section, ask someone else to read it. Because if you read it yourself, it will be easy for you to understand because it comes from you. You already have a familiarity already. But if somebody else read it for the first time, then they can give you some feedback. Tell you, hey, I don't understand this part. Where did this came from? Or I don't know what you're talking about. So then you can then refine your writing to make it clearer for the reader, not for you. By the way, the things that I talked about today, it's not just about for your FYP thesis. It's for any report in general. You can apply the same techniques. Let's move on now to the problem statement. The problem statement essentially is a summary of the formulation. It is a small paragraph, let's say 3 to 5 lines maximum, summarizing the problem formulation. What does that mean? See, this formulation might take maybe 1 page, maybe 3 pages, maybe 5 pages. Don't panic, it's not necessarily 5 pages. What I'm trying to say is that the formulation, it depends on how much you want to write. It's up to you, all right? The space and the size of it. Maybe if your problem is a little bit complex, you want to spend some time to explain it, it's fine, as long as you're not introducing something new here, okay? But then after you've done the formulation, you want to summarize it into one small statement, right? So the reader can read the problem statement and he will understand the gist of all of this. So this way it will become clearer to the reader and for you as well to focus your efforts moving forward. Basically, in this paragraph, you summarize the elements of the problem and what is the gist of the thing that you're facing. And now focus, we are talking just about the problem, not the solution. We haven't even reached that part yet. We are just talking about the problem. So you need to summarize, for example, in Nino's case, for this title right here, it's about the time and effort wasted in disposing garbage. So you need to summarize it in, first you need to formulate it, explain it as much as possible with references and data. And then over here, you can come and summarize it in a concise and specific paragraph form. Any questions so far? Okay, so let's move on. I'm gonna remove this because this was just an example. Okay, so now that we move on to the next section, and that will be actually 1.4 hypothesis. Hypothesis is the proposed solution. A hypothesis is another word for solution, for the proposed solution. And actually the objectives is sort of related to the hypothesis. Yeah, I think so, yeah. So, okay, now that you have explained the problem, now you want to tell me about your proposed solution. How are you gonna solve the problem? And you don't have to be detailed here. Actually, you shouldn't, because that would burn your report. Think about this part that you're writing right here is like the trailer of the movie. In a trailer, I mean, a very good trailer, they do not show everything or a preview. They simply show some parts of the movie just to get you excited to go and watch it. If the bad trailer is when they show everything, the beginning, the start, and the end, and that's it, like the ones they used to have in the 80s. So you watch the trailer, done, the whole movie is over, and you don't even want to watch anything. You've already known the story and the ending and everything. The good trailer is when you get you some elements of the story, but then they hide other elements. So you make you like, hey, what happened there? Or I'd like to know the ending, something like that. So again, the hypothesis or this section should be a preview to your method, not the whole method. So what does that mean? Like maybe you can talk about in generally what you want to do, but then not in detail. So 1.31 here, again, you can call this formulation if you like, or method formulation or hypothesis formulation. And again, explain the same way that this part was written, we also do something similar, but in for the hypothesis. Now, formulate the solution this time. Notice how they are sort of parallel, these two sections. Again, if you'd like to show, if you have some diagrams or charts, explain as much as possible. Again, use references. Now, what do you mean by references? See, the references here, they were used to highlight the problem. Or you can say current practice. Now, you know what, we'll come to that later. But here, the other side, when you do, when you talk about the solution, highlight, potential of the method, yeah. Potential of the solution. What does that mean? Like for example, I don't want to use Arduino, okay, to justify the problem, no, to highlight, or to showcase potential to solve a problem. What's that mean? See, I really want to use Arduino. Okay. Well, maybe you can mention other examples or other solutions or other projects that Arduino helps solve. And you can say that, you know what, Arduino has an already track record of showing great applications. Can you can summarize or show some? You don't have to do a complete review here. Just mention them by name and add the reference. And then later on, when we come to the chapter two, we will talk about this again. But for now, let's mention potential. Like you say, example, when you talk about the formulation here, right, you can say we propose to use Arduino combined with IoT in order to reduce the time for the men doing garbage disposal. IoT or Arduino was successfully used in agriculture applications, in social, in home, smart homes, and in other applications successfully reducing man hours. And then reference 1 and 2 and 3, or 3 and 4 and 5. The details of those activities will be discussed in chapter 2, but for now, this is good enough. So you mention the name of the method, and then mention some references that, you know, show your point. And once again, do not introduce something new here. If you find yourself mentioning a new technology or something new here that was not mentioned before at all, you know what to do now. Come back to this background section and add it there. If you introduce something new here, you will find yourself just wasting a lot of time explaining the item or the new technology. Once again, do not introduce something new here. You put it here. So by the time they reach the hypothesis or the, you know, hypothesis, they already have been introduced to the technology. So then you don't have to waste time explaining it to the reader. They already know or have some have been introduced. So you can straight away focus on your proposed idea. So far, so good. Any questions? If you have any question while I talk, just unmute yourself and go ahead and ask your question. Or raise your hand or something like that. And once again, preview only. Details in chapter 3. Actually, you don't even if you already know the details, you might not fully know the details because you don't know the method yet. You only have an idea. It was not yet a complete methodology. So do not go into much details here. If you have an idea or a concept or a plan, just mention it and mention examples of how this method or this idea was successfully implemented elsewhere. If you can find other examples, this is for you. Yeah? If you can find other examples of interactive garbage bins already in the industry, that's even better. You can just mention that as an example. And then hopefully you can find a way to differentiate between your design and their design. Okay? If you can't find something exact, if you can't find something exactly like yours, then you can mention Arduino and IoT in general in other applications. So earlier I said that objectives are related to the proposal. That's actually true. That's actually 1.32. And that will be the objectives. Now, think of the objectives as exactly as parallel to the statement. What does that mean? The objectives are essentially They are not one paragraph, however, they are simply bullet points. Bullet points, but they do the same job, summarizing the proposed hypo, the proposed hypothesis. There are other people might think of the objectives are not actually a summary of the hypothesis. They have a different purpose, but it's really it's not really that. It's just a matter of way of thinking about it. Now, I wrote this point earlier. So, for example, let's just again use Amiral's project as an example. Yeah. So, how many objectives do you have to do? And objectives are important because I will talk about those, the importance of the objectives in a minute. But let's say you have objective number one, and your objective number one is obviously to do Amiral. You want to build a garbage bin, okay? So you have to think about two sub tasks, and then that's the third one should be test and verify. Okay, so the first one obviously could be identify ideal design for, and then your project, your title or your issue, is that right? And then you can say, but wait, that's, develop a working model. No, that's not measurable. Integrate design into a working model. This is not a research project, so it's fine. It's a FYP project. And then test and verify the model. Working model. You see, this is a nice way of designing or dividing your objectives. Some people, when they write objectives, they write things like, I want to learn as much as possible. I want to improve my... Yes, Amiral, go ahead.
So is it possible to include the sketching in the formulation?
You mean, you mean here?
Yeah, sketching.
Yes, at this early stage of the project, like PR1 is okay. But later on, when we reach PR2 or 3, you have to turn it into a diagram. So I will let it go, or I will accept it for PR1 if it's hands drawn. But then later on, you will have to convert it into a diagram. Is that clear?
Okay, sir.
You will. All right. Now, remove your hand, yeah? Lower your hand. Okay, so essentially, what was I talking about? The objectives. Some people, when they write objectives, they say, I want to learn about project management, or I want to apply what I learned in engineering. I would like to apply the skill, a bunch of other things that I want to and I want to. These are could be your personal objectives, and definitely you will learn these things. But when you're writing an objective for a research or a project, it has to be about the project itself, not about you, the person. Number one. Number two, the objectives has to be measurable, something that we can see and measure and stuff like that. So these are your objectives. More on measurable later on, but for now, these are good enough objectives. Identify ideal design parameters, then develop the model, use those, don't copy and paste this, parameters, and develop a working model, okay? And then test and verify the model. Now, when we say ideal design parameters, we don't want you just to, for example, this is an example about garbage disposal, smart garbage disposal. We don't want you to build a smart garbage bin just for the sake of building it. We don't care. If we wanted that, we could hire someone professional, and he will build someone very good and very nice disposal. And no offense, it would be better than the one that you want to build, because they are professionals and this is their job, and they're probably well trained and well experienced. But what we want from you, or the purpose of building the model, is not just to build the model, but also to learn from it, and also to verify that you have met your hypothesis, or that you have solved the problem. So the purpose of your model is not just to build, but also to solve this problem. So Amiro's case, once again, his problem is to say that, or his problem says that currently there's a lot of people, or there's a lot of waste, and there's a lot of time and effort being wasted. Okay, now after you build this model, you have to show us how your model is going to reduce cost. So this is where the test and verify part comes in. We don't want you, when we say test and verify, we don't mean test that is working or not. No, we test and verify that the model can resolve or can solve a problem. I don't actually copy paste what I'm writing here. I'm just explaining what the objective should be written about. The first objective is about identifying the ideal parameters. What is the ideal parameter? Ideal parameters that will meet your plan here. Or then, you know, for example, he wants to build an interactive garbage bin. One of the ways to make it interactive is through LED light. But there are several ways of doing LED light. I can make a small lamp, a big light, and so on and so forth. So which one is the ideal then is the one that is going to work? So you want the worker to see the light from far away, day and night. So you have to have something that's very visibly clear. When you identify which design of LED will work, then that is the ideal design parameter. I hope that makes sense now to everyone. So when we don't want just to build an LED that only works in your room. No, we want it to be in action because it will really resolve the problem that you mentioned. We don't ask you to build the model to, oh, sir, it's working. Oh, thank you, congratulations, you graduated, finish your job. No, it doesn't work that way. We want to see that your model actually resolves the problem that you mentioned here. Okay? So that's the first part, which is identifying parameters. Okay, next, once you identify the parameters, actually build your model. Make it. Whether it's a simulated model, or whether it's an actual prototype, you have to build it, whether it's in simulation or in actual, I suggest both. And then once you have these two ready, then you test your model. Zap-less. Because if you developed one model, fine. If you developed multiple models, let's say one for simulation and one for actual. By the way, although no more MCO for you guys or no more virtual for you, you can still develop a simulation. But then it will have to be complemented with an actual prototype. Is that clear? What I'm trying to say is that earlier we were talking about only virtual, but this time you can still do the virtual things or the simulated things, but that will act as a complement, as an extra, but you still have to develop an actual prototype. So your actual prototype must demonstrate your hypothesis, and demonstrate in the sense that it successfully performs whatever you propose here and successfully solves the problem that you highlighted here. Does that make sense? How these three items are all connected, the problem formulation, the hypotheses, and the objectives. And this is how we know that your objectives have been met. And I'm sure you've heard this expression before many times. I have met my objectives, or I have successfully achieved my objectives. What does that mean? Well, you have successfully identified the correct and ideal parameters. You have built the working model, okay? And then your model actually verified and was able to successfully demonstrate my hypothesis. And what that means that it was able to solve this problem. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, ideally speaking, only three objectives, no need for more than that. More than that would be too much. So hypothesis, what comes after that? We will come back to the hypothesis later on when we talk about chapter 5, but for, excuse me, the objectives. They will be with us later on when we talk about chapter 5, but for now, it's good enough. You know what? Let's talk about that right now, because it's important for you to understand the relationship between objectives and conclusions. In chapter 5 or 6, towards the end of your thesis, you have to write conclusions. And the conclusions are directly related to your objectives. Let's just say chapter 5.1. And basically, what do you mean by directly related to your objectives? Basically speaking, we will just take those objectives and put them here. And then conclusion number one is going to answer objective number one. Conclusion number one, answer objective number one. And so on and so forth. What does that mean? See, earlier when you wrote your objective one, you said that you want to identify the ideal parameters. Okay, have you identified the ideal parameters? If the answer is yes, then you can summarize those ideal parameters. And this way we can see that you have successfully achieved objective number one. Then similarly, objectives number two and three. Objective number two was that you wanted to build your model. Have you successfully built the models? Yes. And if yes, then you have met this objective again. Then finally, have you verified? Then you can summarize the results and you can put it here. So some people or some examiners, when they look at theses, whether it's FYP or whatever, right, or you know, master's or PhD, they will focus on only these two. They will read your objectives and then they will jump to chapter five and read your conclusions. And then we compare. If your conclusions do answer the objectives, we are good to go. You have completed your work. But if your objectives are in one world and the conclusions are in another world altogether, then you have not met your objectives. And therefore, there is no point for me to read your report altogether. I personally do that, but I know many other examiners, the very first thing they read is the objectives and conclusions. They even skip the abstract altogether. Maybe they will read the abstract quickly just to get an idea about your title, but then they will straight away jump to the objectives and then jump to the conclusions and compare. Have you met your objectives? Yes. If yes, then we are good to go, we are friends, and then I'm going to read your report. But if you have not met objectives and your conclusions are something else, then I don't waste my time. So that's why put a mental note somewhere that your objectives will eventually will be required to be answered in your conclusions. That's why I ask, that's why things like I want to learn about project management. How are you going to conclude that? How are you going to say, yes, I learned? Okay, how did you learn? You need to demonstrate that you learned. There's no way for you to demonstrate this unless you sit for a test or something. That's why it's something that we cannot measure. This is what I meant by measurable, something that we can see, we can visualize, we can put it in a chart, a diagram, a table, we can then visualize, we can actually see it physically or whatever. So that's how conclusions should be planned later on. But when you have the objectives, you have to have a mental note somewhere that the objectives will be meant to be answered later on by the conclusion. So far, so good. Any questions about the objectives and conclusions? Okay, the next element of your chapter, this is, by the way, all of this is still chapter one, by the way. The next and last element of your chapter one is this code. And I think I'm going to ask Amirul again because he's my best friend today. Amirul, does your work or does your project involve robotics? Are you going to build a robot? Yes or no?
Model. Models.
Yes. Are you going to build a robot?
Yes, sir.
Really? What is the robot going to do?
Sorry, you mean the model of the garbage or the...
No, I know that you're going to develop an interactive garbage bin, or let's call it a smart garbage bin. That's your model. Aside from that, are you going to build a robot?
No, sir.
So the answer is no, right? Okay, another question, and again, yes or no answers, yeah? Are you going to do CFD analysis?
Sorry, sir?
If you didn't know what CFD, that means it's you're not going to do it. Are you going to do CFD analysis? Yes or no?
No, sir.
No. Are you going to involve some chemical analysis?
No, sir.
So see, all of these things are outside the scope of your project. So hopefully now you know what the meaning of the scope. Okay, if these things are outside the scope of your project, then what is inside the scope of your project? That you have to answer here. See, think about the scope is, that's what I meant by what is the inside of your scope. if these things you have to mention, okay, let me ask you a little again. Yeah, how are you? The best way to answer this part is to ask yourself, how am I going to do this? How am I going to do how am I going to achieve the objectives? So let me help you, Amir, yeah, because I already bothered you with so many questions. You're obviously going to do some electronic design. Is that right? Some circuit.
Yes.
Yes? So that's here. Yes. Electronic design. Is that right? Arduino-based electronic circuit, so something like that. Arduino-based. Are you going to build a simulation or just a prototype? So maybe a simulation, maybe a prototype. Is that right? So you can see what I'm doing right now. Basically, you're going to summarize what you're going to do in your project. In order to achieve the objectives of this work, we're going to do the following. I'm going to do the following. We're going to utilize electronic circuit design control, Arduino-based, that would involve Arduino programming languages. Once the circuit is developed, we will initially build it in simulation, then we will build an actual circuit, and then we will use that to develop a working prototype of the smart pen. So far, so good? That's your project, Amiro, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, after you did all of that, after you built the model, what are you going to do with it?
Equation, sir?
After you build the smart garbage bin, what are you going to do with it? What are you going to do with it? Are you going to say, oh, I built the model, hey, finish, FYP finish, is that it?
Introduce to the others.
No, not like that. You have to test your model. Testing and verification. Okay, it's right there in your objectives. But how are you going to know that your model actually worked? So you have to here define briefly how you are going to verify your project. Your model. Okay, your model is supposed to help reduce the time required to do the garbage disposal. Is that right? So if that's the case, you have to develop a test design a test that is going to showcase that. Maybe you can say using a conventional bin, the guy will have to walk 10 meters and waste, 10 minutes. And then you wouldn't know, and then the thing will be, let's say 20% of the time, that will be a waste of time. So that will be the amount of time wasted. But if you use a smart bin, the guy would know from far away, it's already empty. So he doesn't have to go there, so therefore save the time. So you have to develop some sort of an experiment that will result in some form of tables and charts and parameters. So you need to define an experiment or a test, and also define a parameter. In your case, the parameter is, or parameters, point of one, parameters, it's time, cost, I don't know what else, man hours is also time, so that actually can then, then you want to show with numbers, yeah, with data, that your project will result in less time, less cost, and less man hours. This way, you can then present these charts or diagrams that will show that you have met your objectives, that you have verified or demonstrated your hypotheses, that you have successfully answered or solved the problem. So I hope now how all of these elements now play together. See, first you define the problem, then you mention how or the idea of your solution. Next, you specify how you're going to do that, or how you're going to achieve that idea. Then the procedure itself, which is the testing, development of the model, and then testing it and verification of it. Then now you will have a complete idea how your project is going to be developed and written. Chapter one is the beginning of your thesis, but it's basically the foundation of the whole thing. If you understand every one of these sections and it's written clearly, then you have a clear path ahead. Because you know how to do this, it's already a clear idea. You already know how to do this, and of course how to answer this, and then it will basically they will work together. By the time you if you successfully complete your scope or you follow your scope ideas, you would then successfully answer the objectives. And of course, when you do that, you also will be able, I mean, it's at the same time it will happen. By the time you meet your objective, you'd also verify your theory, which in turn means that you have solved the problem. So all you really need to focus is here about your project. But in order for you to define the scope properly, then you need to have defined these sections also properly. The scope has to be something specific about your own project. It cannot be something general. If it's something for any, if it's something general for anyone else, any other project, then it wouldn't work. It has to be something particular about your project. Is that clear how it all works together? Now, when you write chapter one for PR1, and you might make mistakes or you might not fully understand what's going on, it's clearly understood. We will work on this together, but hopefully by the time you reach PR2 and you update it, then clearly it will become easier and clearer for you. Any questions about chapter one? All of that was just chapter one. The later chapters are actually relatively easier to write, but any questions so far? Okay, I'm going to talk about chapter two only because you know what? We do have time for the other chapters. Yeah. So chapter two, literature review. If you remember, we already mentioned literature review twice. Is that right? We mentioned references here, and we mentioned references here. And the first time we mentioned references, it was to highlight the problem. Is that right? I'm going to actually copy this line. I'm going to put it here. And then we use the references again to highlight the potential of the solution. Is that right? And we put it here. And that's it. That's chapter two. But more. Elaborate more. So basically, chapter two will be divided into two sections. 2.1, we're going to call it current practice or the situation today before your project. Or the current situation before your project. And in here, you highlight, you mention, you do your review. Review current or past projects, reports, anything, by the way, articles, FYP reports from previous students, internet articles. It doesn't matter what the source is, of course, but of course, preferably journals. But journals is sort of advanced. Of course, yeah, I should have mentioned it in the beginning. Journals, journal articles, yeah. And then basically, that's where you do your review. Now, this part of the review is where you highlight basically the problem that you mentioned. Now, earlier, when you were writing the hypothesis, you just briefly mentioned those situations. But in here, in chapter one, in chapter two, you go detail. Now, we don't want you to bring every paper in the world. We just want you to mention those that are related to your problem. Like Amiral, again, he's talking about time wasting. Or that's the problem that he mentioned here, that they're actually wasting a lot of time and money. Well, the references that you include here must also talk about that. Maybe there are different ways or different reasons why there is a waste of time. They walk a lot, they drive in the wrong way or something like that. You have to find different ways or different examples of how applications or how garbage disposal is being wasted. And the second section of your chapter is about your method. You want to use Arduino so you can say potential solution or proposed solution, potential solution. In here, you also reuse the reviews, but then you review projects and titles that highlight the method that you want to use. So you can actually bring, again, details about Arduino projects, maybe similar designs that successfully reduce time, and so on and so forth. So this will be your evidence that your method actually does work. And if you don't believe me, you can read those other reports, and they successfully succeeded. So if they succeeded, then I can succeed as well. So that's the point of the potential solution. The potential solution reviews. I see the first section, 2.1, was the reviews to justify your problem or to explain the problem. But the second reviews are to showcase your method and how your method or your proposed method can work. Now, sometimes the method that you want to do is not available in one place. Maybe you don't have what your method Amiral is, Arduino, garbage disposal with IoT. So maybe you couldn't find an exact same thing like, you know, these three elements together. No problem. If you couldn't find it exactly the same way, then you can do it in pieces. Like review Arduino first, review garbage disposal separately, even if they don't have Arduino or whatever, right? Just garbage disposal in general, right? Disposals. Yeah. And also then review IoT separately. But of course, if you could find something that includes all three elements, then good. If you couldn't, then you review elements of your method. So either your method directly or elements of your method. Okay. So I'm going to take all of this and put it back here. And then review your method or propose method or elements of it. Okay. So far, so good, guys. And then optionally, you can add another section. This is not optionally, I mean, this is preferred summary of the review. Basically, this is a summary section, very, very short section, maybe one page long. This is summarize those guys right here, summarize section 1 and 2. And the point of the summary is for you to have a clear understanding of the situation today. So clear. Now, the point of literature review is that by the time you finish the reviews and everything, then you will have a clear idea about your method. You will have a clear understanding of what your method is going to look like. Hopefully, when you actually do the reviews from here, you will have a clear understanding, clear idea of your method. And that will help you in the next chapter, which is chapter 3. And then copy it, okay. So copy and then we come here, and then that will be chapter 3. Chapter 3 will be the methodology. Once again, in the methodology, what are you going to be including? Essentially, first of all, outline of the method itself. Outline means summary, which is this part right here. Idea of your method. Basically, you have to summarize it in a diagram, chart diagram, a block diagram, and then the method. Basically, the details of your step. How you're going to build it, the parts, the components, the design, the pictures, and the step, the procedure to put it all together. The details are all you put here. And then at the end, that this is probably 3.1 and this 3.2. Maybe if you want to break this down into sections, like 3.2, 3.3, it's up to you. But then at the end, there's one more thing in the end, which is testing. This is next section. The last part of your methodology is your actual model. So what does that mean? See, in the beginning of your chapter 3, you will have the plan for your model, the idea of how you're going to achieve your model, how you're going to build your model. Then you have the process to build it. So by the time you finish that process, then you should have completed the thing. So by then you will have the process, then you will have the model completely here. You can take pictures of the actual, or also take pictures of the simulation if you have it as well. Okay. Then again, once you finish the methodology, then, and by the way, the methodology here should be also briefly mentioned in the scope right here. So very brief idea what it is, but then the details are here. Then chapter 4 will be results, finding the results. Results. Now, the importance of the results part is right here. You see, when we said earlier on that over here, after we build the prototype, we're going to test it. And the purpose of the testing is not just to show that it works or not, but to show that it's able to achieve my objectives. that is actually able to reduce time and whatever, right? So then here you can basically specify the situation. First of all, 4.1 is testing procedure. Explain to the leader what is your test is going to be like. How is your test is going to, and also the parameters. In your case, Amir, that would be time, cost, and so on and so forth. In other people's project, maybe different parameters. And then you will have here, then after you explain the test, then perform the test, then the actual test. You can then perform the test, record the data, and then upload or put the data results. Perform test or tests, and then show results, charts, diagrams, simulation diagrams, and stuff like that. I mean, everything, any kind of output will be useful here. All right? I'm not sure if I put results in discussion or just results. If you want to put discussion here, also can discussion. See, discussion means what? See, after you find the result, all we see right now is just table, just numbers, right? The next part right here, this section is the most important section of the whole thesis. This, because right here, you're going to discuss your results. Discuss your results and showcase how your data actually verify your objectives. Or not verify, achieve your objectives. Okay, wait a minute. See, this is a very important part for you to understand. Okay, let's say you did the test, and the test shows, let's say, for example, Amiro, yeah? Amiro built this model, and then he tested it. And the test shows that using this model, we will get 20% reduction in waste management time. 20% reduced time. Okay, if that's true, then you can simply come here and argue. You can say, since the results show 20% reduced time, therefore, what is it? Yeah, right here. Therefore, I have successfully identified the ideal parameters because they are indeed there. How do you know they are the ideal? Because whatever model that I built actually worked and reduced time. And in doing so, I have successfully verified that my method was successful, which also in turn means that I have provided a solution to this problem. So right here is the key element of your project, is the tests, not the model. Some people think that by building a model that the project is completed. No, you can build whatever you want, but if your model does not show the results, what if Amiro built the model, but then the model actually requires more time to dispose the garbage? That's even worse, or maybe it doesn't save time at all, it's just the same. So the model that Amiro built is pointless, or it does not have any value. If that's the case, then you did not successfully achieve your objectives. So once again, the point of the project is not just to build the model, but actually to showcase that it does work. Is that point clear for everyone?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, so once you've done with this, then from here on in, it's just conclusions and closure, basically. So here you have chapter 5, which is conclusions. You can basically add recommendations if you have any recommendations for others or future works or whatever. And then after that, you have references and appendix. And the details about the references and the appendix are in the guidelines. They're straightforward. I also want to talk about the appendix real quick. The appendix, the point of the appendix is that whatever you write in the report itself, sometimes in the middle of the report you want to put a program, for example, right? But you don't put the whole program, because the whole program could be about 1,000 lines or maybe 500 lines. So that would be a very big chunk, and maybe about 10 pages of program. If you put that in the middle of your report, it's going to be, it's going to disrupt the whole thing. So in order for you to avoid disrupting the flow of your thesis, you just take the important part of your program, let's say to highlight the key elements of your program, and you put that in the middle of your thesis. And then the rest of the program, you put it in the appendix. So you can say a complete program or code. You can say manuals or references. Of course, not references, I mean manual. Sometimes some industries they have their own manual books or guideline books that have data in it, so you can put that here, or you can if it's not so much, and other things that you want to put in the appendix. Now the appendix is optional, of course. If you don't have a program or manual, then you don't have anything, but it's fine. But if you want to, maybe when you did the simulation, you developed 25 diagrams for analysis. You don't put all 25 diagrams, you put the important ones only, maybe two or three, maybe five, but then the rest, you don't want to waste them, so what do you do with them? You put them in the appendix. That's another example of not disrupting your thesis. You can tell the reader that, okay, the analysis are extensive, and right now I'm showing only five pages, the rest of the diagrams are in the appendix. Then it's up to the reader. If they want to go to the appendix and see the rest of the results, then they can go and do it on their own. If they are happy with five or the diagrams that you included, then it's good to go. So then this way, you can call this section data. Whatever information that you have here that is extensive, that could be disruptive to the flow of your thesis, simply put it here. Anything that can disrupt the flow of your thesis. Okay? Any questions so far? So, about this. So that's basically what you should include into your chapter. If you notice, I spend a lot of time on introduction, because introduction is the foundation of your thesis. And I know that when you write your PR1, it might not be perfect, this introduction. It's okay. But by the time you finish PR2, and PR2, yes, then you should have the complete version of your chapter one. Okay? Another thing to understand about your project, that there is something fundamental that you must do now, which is literature review. As you can see, literature review is right here into your problem formulation, and it's also right here, assuming this is the hypothesis, and it's right here into your problem formulation. Without having references, then you cannot justify that the problem you are talking about is important. And without references, you cannot justify that your idea has a potential. So you really have to do literature review. And I know what you're thinking. 1 week, not enough. So for now, for this PR one, if you can have like few references, then it's fine. But as you go between PR1 and PR2, you will have to dedicate that time for references. When is the PR2 ready? I think it's very short time between PR1 and PR2. What is it? I think 2 weeks later, is that it?
PR2 will be on 29 March.
I think so. 3 weeks later. So in this 3 weeks between PR2 and PR1, you'll have to dedicate that time entirely for literature review. Because literature review is the fundamental basis of your project. It gives you idea for your method. It gives you more justification for your problem. It gives you more examples. So the minimum for me, acceptable references total is about 20 to 30 references. Actually, I usually go for 60, but for your level, undergraduate, maybe 20 and 30 is fine. But for now, for PR1 and PR, for PR1, maybe 5 or 6 is fine. But by the time you reach PR2, you should have at least 30, or 25 to 30 references. Without having enough references, you would not have enough ideas of how to do your project. So by the time you reach or complete, and if you're thinking, oh my God, 30 references, what am I going to do? When am I going to do all of that? You don't have to read the whole paper, actually. You only need to read the abstract, methodology, and that's it. So you don't really have to read the whole details of the report. You just have to read only the background, the objectives, and then the method. That's all. Just get ideas, but then definitely you need volume here. Our Unitel library has extensive online bases. You can access it remotely from your home. You just have to register, and then you will get access to all global references resources, such as articles, papers, and much, much more. So there's no excuse to, I cannot find this, or I couldn't find any references. No, you can. I can show you now if you want. Just Google disposable or smart disposable garbage, and you find plenty on Google alone, let alone these other resources. Is that clear for everyone? I mean, for you, everyone?
Yeah.
Okay, so now, any questions about the expectations of your thesis? Okay, so this is the case. We will stop now. I'm going to stop this session, but we will have another session right after this where we continue with the second topic, which is what to do in FYP1. So.